So total 13 students, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I will present my slides. So my screen is visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the topic I wanted to present you, like, do's and don'ts in research. And this topic covers research and what are the do's and what are the don'ts and ethical status of research. So what should be a research? A research must demonstrate logical, structured and defensible reasoning based on credible and verifiable evidence presented in such a way that it makes an original contribution to knowledge. So research should be a genuine work, and that should be contributed some contribution to the existing knowledge. But in PhD researchers, the only people who carefully read a given thesis are supervisors, the examiners and the candidates. You know, the thesis which the PhD work which has been done by a candidate, and the candidate undergone guidance and supervision of a supervisor, and sometimes the candidate may consult with some faculties, some experts, etc. And all these people only will be able to read the work of the candidate. That is a problem of the research work. And there are some issues and effect of this. So these are all my perceptions on research. My perception sometimes may be wrong for you. So you can take whatever you like to take from me. Okay. So motivation, why should I do research? Why should you do research? There are some motivations. The motivation may be internal drive and external drive. Internal drive, research interest, like sense of achievement, fulfillment, and curiosity. So some people have research interest. It's an internal research interest. So that drive is very important for doing research. And the second one is strong ambition. Some people have strong ambition to become research and PhD. You know, there are people like that. So apart from that, there is an external drive, like degree and diploma. Some people wanted to do PhD. So to get a degree, PhD, some it's highest academic degree in the world, that is PhD. Then academic job. So some people request to work in a government college or a college or university or IIMs or IITs as teachers. So for that purpose, it's not essential, it is a must. Then some people do research by the influence of parents, teachers and friends. And some people do with peer pressure. So I would like to say internal drive is better than the external drive. Okay. So are you able to hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the research is a long journey. You might have seen this slide before. your life ambition, and you know there are people with highly ambitious in the beginning time, and their ambition may be slightly downward after a period of time when they started research. And in the beginning, they feel like the world here I am coming, such like win a Nobel Prize. Their ambition may be like that, win a Nobel Prize and revolutionize your field. And then the graph is downward, get a job at a top university, then get a job, any job. And when the years has been passed, and they may like to attend a conference, and after that hope they have pepperoni pizza. Okay, so this is a way in which some the scholars, you might have seen the scholars that when they're coming, they were very active, and after 1 year and second year, third year, when they are reaching to finish the work, their motivation may be reduced. So what are the reasons behind this reduction of this life ambition? Okay, so you can think about that. So my presentation, whether the research have an appropriate title, though, so I would like to say about the research titles, and whether sampling and the respondent selected are appropriate. So I would like to say about sampling, whether the objective is set in accordance with the title, whether the hypothesis are matching with objectives available theories, whether the findings of the study have answered all the objectives raised by the researcher, whether tools applied for hypothesis testing test appropriate. So I will touch all these things: sampling, hypothesis, objectives, and the testing a hypothesis, and the title of the work. Okay. So I don't know how far I can complete this. So there are some PhD discomforts, are the PhD supervisors being monsters or mentors? See, you might have experienced like this PhD disasters, how to avoid them. So there are sometimes you may have some conflict with your research supervisor. Sometimes the PhD research supervisors seems like a monster, so there are some experiences, and sometimes they are real mentors. Okay, so how to avoid these kind of conflicts? And there are always superior supervisor relationship that just don't function. This is very important. There should be a better relationship between supervisor and supervisee in research. So sometimes the relationship may be broken. What to do to have a better relationship? So that also a research candidate should practice, to have a better relationship with the supervisor. So are the supervisors being available and skilled to supervise the scholars? This is very important. Whether the supervisor is been skilled, so there is a skill is essential. Some supervisors, you know, that they are just like dummy and go and collect data and analyze it and present it or submit it that the way. They just like sitting and they won't help the candidate. So there are some skills are required to supervise. So whether the supervisors are skillful or not, that's very important. Then are the supervisors being real supervisors? So sometimes the real supervisors are not the real supervisors. So like that, okay. Are the JRF scholars justify their scholarship funds for their work? So you know, if you pass the UGC JRF, you will get around 40,000 rupees per month in the first 2 years, and after from the third year onwards you will get SRF. So SRF amount will be up to 3 years, so altogether 5 years you will get the scholarships. So whether the scholarship funds given by the central government and UGC are justifiable, and are you doing the research which is essentially required for the society? So that's very important. Then, well, the UGC benefited out of the funding to JRF scholars in terms of good papers and research outcomes. So are the papers published by the scholars recently? MPhil interview, yeah, you are interviewing some of these students, some of the candidates, and they have come across they were telling like they have paper, and the paper was published in a journal called Mukti Shabd. The journal is not a journal, and the journal was removed. And it's not removed, it is actually a clone journal. Clone journal means somebody like just imitating the ISBN number and the name of another good journal and published in somewhere. It's banned. It is a banned thing. When you say and when you disclose your paper in any of the administrators, it is a crime. So when you publish papers, you should be careful. It is a original, genuine journal or not. So whether the university and research centers support the scholars in terms of research infrastructure. So it's very important. So are the universities are able to support the scholars in terms of research infrastructure? So you can compare the infrastructure with the other universities and IIMs. So you will get a result out of that. Then are the PhD findings produced are good for policy decision making? So these are the questions. Then again, are the PhD scholars really involved in his or her research work? So involvement is very important. We can find scholars, they are really involved in their research work. And we can also find the research scholars, they are not involved in their own research work. So it can be disclosed in the pre-submission presentation or SRF presentation or open defense. So we can find that the scholar is involved or not involved. So if the scholar is able to answer the question raised by the people very, very well, then we would like to say that the scholar is really involved. So sometimes a simple question from the topic asked by the audience, the scholar is not able to answer that. So this is a pathetic condition if the scholar is not involved in the research work. Then are the fee structure of PhD is uniform across the state and institutions? Fee structure of PhD. So some state universities, they are not charging fees. Kerala University, if you register Kerala University, with JRF, you will get the fellowship and there is no necessary to pay fees. But if you register PhD in some of the private or deemed universities, you have to pay annual fees. Okay. Then are the universities follows the standard pattern of procedures which is followed by the good universities? So it's again another debatable topic. Are the administrative machinery being smooth for the speedy governance of PhD process? Administrative machinery has been strong or not? Then is there any mechanism functioning in the university to solve grievance of a PhD scholar? Are the scholars have the quality of integrity? Are the feasible topics are admitted by the universities for research and funding? So these are the questions I can raise. So you have to find answers. Okay. I should focus on the research. Key ingredient of research contribution. So one major contribution is better than many small ones. So you should be careful whether the research is really a contribution to the existing knowledge. So you have to check that. If it is not contributed to any existing knowledge, that research will be a waste. So when you find the topic for MPhil as well as PhD, so you have to consider the very important factor, contribution of research to the society or present knowledge. Then what is the contribution type, like knowledge discovery, invention, integration, application, etc.? So identify, describe, and demonstrate the big data, asking the purpose is innovation. So your topic would be in then how to find research problems. Okay, so this is another Herculean task faced by the research scholars. They are in shortage of problems. Many people approaching me, sir, will you give a problem? So I always say that I'm not a problem giver. So this is a very, relevant question nowadays. So how to find research problem? So when the scholars, they are sending the synopsis for the doctoral committee, they like they are not able to get the problem, the feasible problem. Sometimes the problem is feasible, the doctoral committee may reject the topic. Okay. So follow your interest and work on problems you enjoy. Remember, quality of work requires passion. Start with simple ideas and extend them. So doing collaborative works, this is very important. So when your problem is selected. So where do ideas for research come from? So research ideas, sources of research ideas. So sometimes you will get ideas teaching students questions. Some of you have experience in teaching. So when sometimes the students ask questions, some questions are very relevant one, and from these questions you can find a research topic. Working closely with doctoral students, so you can find the topics, you can find the catalog which is already registered by the scholars, and from this you can generate problems. Then reading the literature, so existing literature you can read. Networking is also important. If you have opportunity, you can go for the conferences. So the conference are really the sources of new problems. So there are a lot of new papers will be presented in the conferences. So that conference papers finally go for publication. So my experience is the conference, attending conference is very, very important. Just a minute. So networking, what is networking? Networking means when you attend conferences, you have the opportunity to meet many people from different universities, different institutions, and you can discuss the topic with them, and you can maintain the contact. And so simply, this is a methodology for publications also. So you can collaborate. So collaboration is very important in publication. In social science researchers. So some of you might have seen that the publications and which comes from four or five persons together. So the five persons are from five different universities. So collaboration is very important. Then contact with the real world, like field visits, working with the practitioners, reading practitioners' literature, consulting. It's also very important for getting of problems. Then curiosity about things. Intuitions, analogies, real-life observations is also very important for finding out the research problems. There are good versus bad research problems. Okay, so good research problem means after the research, more people will be doing it. You open the door. So if you have a topic and you have published the topic, after that many people cited you. So you might have experienced the citation. So citation based on the citation score. So if you want to get more citation, your topic should be interested one. So if after the research more people will be doing it, that means your research is an interested one. So you open the door, so you will get more citations. You know, nowadays the quality of the teachers, it's not based on the teaching and but based on the research and publication. There are times in which the teachers who like teach interestingly and emotionally like that, but nowadays that teachers and that era was gone, and nowadays the teacher's quality depends on the quality of the publication by the teacher. and what about their citation score? So in the Kerala University, you can find the teachers, especially science teachers, they have citation score more than 3,000. They have close to 3,000. Okay, so citation is very important. Citation means based on your work, somebody cited you for the other works. So after the research, nobody can improve it. She closed the door. So that's also a good research problem. When you do the research, nobody is interested to improve it, then you can close the door and stop it. Okay. So there are bad research problem. Nobody will follow the research. There are people, I'm experienced, and when soon after they publish a paper and they will inform through mail or something, please cite me. So that way they can improve the citation. So that's not an ethical part of publication and research. So it's spontaneously, the citation will come up spontaneously, naturally, when you search in the Google and find the paper, and if the paper is good, we can cite. So like that. So bad research problem, nobody will follow the research, and nobody really cares about the research. Okay. So this is the bad research problem. So please don't take the bad research problems. So always your research problem should be good. So any questions so far? Yes, any questions, any comments? Asha?
Yes, sir.
Asha is there? Yes, any questions,
sir, yes,
from the audience?
Nobody
is here. You are not asking questions, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Then you can ask. So you are understanding my presentation or not understanding it?
Yes, sir, we are understanding.
You understand?
Yes.
Then you don't have questions. So, or else you will ask soon after the presentation something. You don't want to disturb me by the time, right, presenting, right? Okay, shall I continue?
Yes, sir.
So, principle of aim high, accept low. Aim high, you do not patch a small hole left by leading researchers. Find a more fundamental problem which may have long impact. So when you select your problems, you select a fundamental problem. That's very important. The problem should be a real problem. Somebody just cooped up the problems. That is not essentially required. So cooking up the problem is not good. So your problem is really a fundamental problem. Problem means research questions or research topic. That is a fundamental problem. So accept low. If it is difficult to find fundamental problem, then we need a compromise. So there are disciplines in which the problem is shortage. Sometimes the problem is in shortage. I remember our MG, Mahatma Gandhi University Vice Chancellor, sir, once explained to us in a conference. So if you don't have problem, come with me, I will give you problems. So you can take the advice of professors and colleagues if you are shortage of problems. It's also no problem. You can ask, sir, what is a relevant topic in nowadays? We can do research like that. So nurturing good taste, there are many mediocre papers published. So don't ruin your taste by poor quality papers. So it's very important. So when you publish, so there are indexes, you have heard that, Scopus, Web of Science, ABDC, And there is a list published by the UGC, which is called UGC Care List. So UGC Care List is the second category list, or the journalists which has been not listed in the Scopus and Web of Science are compiled of the Care List, which is a lowest index. So there are indexes like Scopus, Web of Science, APDC. So if you publish paper in these indexes, so you will be rewarded. So if you publish paper in APDC A star category, so you will get be placed. Even you get a job in IA. So when you publish a paper in a A star journal, okay. So ABDC. ABDC means Australian Business Dean's Council Index. Scopus is an index. Web of Science is an index. So there are journals which are being indexed. So when you search for a journal and you first of all check it, what indexation the journal have, whether the journal is indexed in Scopus, whether the journal is indexed in Web of Science, or whether the journal is indexed in ABDC. So then only you can publish. You try to publish a paper in a journal. So indexation is very important. You know that there are stocks which has been listed in NSE, means quality stocks, because the listing norms of NSE is very, very strict. So the stocks or the companies listed in NSE are having a good quality. So similarly, there are journals which are been indexed are having good quality. So learn to appreciate good papers and criticize poor papers. So when you read papers and if the paper is good, you can appreciate. And when you publish a paper in Elsevier or Web of Science or Scopus Index journals, you can publicize, you can post it in the Facebook or Instagram that you publish it. So it's very important. Logic reason for the empirical researchers. So why you are doing research? So social sciences, as always, we have hypothesis. The hypothesis can be proven or refuted. So for example, the stock market do not provide returns to the investors. That is a null hypothesis. You can test it with the number of stocks, and you can find that the stocks really provide returns. Nowadays, the stock market is in upward trend, people getting 50 to 60% return. When you invest in a bank deposit, you will get 6%. 6% return from the bank deposit by the time 60% return from the stock. So this hypothesis is absolutely nonsense. So you can say that the stock market provides returns to the investors based on the evidences. So you can prove that. So this claim can be tested by collecting data and then use statistics to test whether the statement is true or false. So replication refers to the process by which prior findings can be retested. Sometimes the earlier tested findings which can be retested with the new data. So there are some people change their perception for the cross-sectional data. So when you collect data from the people in 1 year back, and the same questionnaire used to collect now, sometimes the result may be changed because of the changes of the perception of the people. That is called retesting of the data, that you can do that. Okay. So logic reasons for the empirical researchers, generalizability in empirical social science. There are many questions asked by the audience or faculties when you present your work. How can we generalize your research findings? So that's a major question. Does an empirical statement only apply to single case? Does it only explain why United States and Canada, or it can be generalized to the whole world? So the population should be homogeneous in this case, then we can generalize the result. If the population is heterogeneous, we are not in a position to generalize. So that the people always asking to take random sampling instead of purposive sampling, then we can generalize. So there are qualitative and quantitative research. You might have experience in qualitative and quantitative research. Qualitative research means research that involves few observations, like case study method is part of qualitative, or you are analyzing some textual data. So qualitative research are in-depth examinations of the case in hand, and the quantitative are based on statistics or numbers. So you are able to measure quantitatively. So that means the quantitative data analysis you can follow that. So qualitative and quantitative is two different things. Some researchers are qualitative and some researchers are quantitative. So when you do take research of social work, sociology, they are all doing qualitative research. Political science, history people, they are doing qualitative research. But in commerce, management, science, they are doing quantitative research. So theories, concepts, variables, and hypotheses. So theories are very important. Any doubt so far? Any questions? Nobody asking questions. So why are you hesitant to ask questions to me? So I explained the problem, how to find the problem. Please ask me some questions. So somebody has left the meeting. Ananya Prasad. Yes. Ask Neela.
Can you please once again explain about the difference between quantitative and qualitative? It's not clear for me, sir.
Yes. Sure. I will explain. Then, what more? Any other questions?
Sir, is the methodology for qualitative research different from that of quantitative?
Yes. Then, what else?
Can you please explain?
I will explain. Qualitative and quantitative. I will explain. Yeah. Okay. So qualitative research is based on in-depth examination of a thing. Maybe in-depth examination of an institution, or in-depth examination of a person or a group. This is called qualitative research. Sometimes textual data is very important in qualitative research. So it's non-numerical. So in social science also, you may practice the qualitative research, like you will try to capture the effect of perception of people. So suppose you are doing research of job satisfaction of an employee. This is qualitative, but that case. You may capture the data in 5-point Likert scale or 7-point Likert scale. And the perception may be collected from the respondents. Perception, maybe you may collect the perception like strongly agree, neutral, disagree, and strongly disagree. So this is a qualitative research, but you are giving numbers for the strongly agree statements. Then the qualitative data, you converted into quantitative. So that is a part of quantitative research, not qualitative research. So that in social science, commerce and management is a part of quantitative research, because you are converting the qualitative data into quantitative. But this qualitative research are pure qualitative research, purely based on the case study, interviews, observation, and all. So these two methodologies are different. Many people will be confused about the qualitative and quantitative research. So the research in political science, history, sociology, are qualitative researches. Even law people also doing qualitative research. They are checking the case verdicts, whether the judgment of the case is as per the existing rule, or the judgment against the verdict against the rules. So they are findings. They are finding the whether the laws are moving in a correct path or not. This is qualitative. But in commerce and management, people are doing research quantitative way. So quantitative means even though there are topics which is qualitative, but we are converting the concepts into numerical way with the help of these kind of scales. You understand? So it's a very, very vast topic. Even one day is required to teach qualitative and quantitative research. There are many researches under qualitative and quantitative. So case study is a part of qualitative research. Ethnography is a part of qualitative research. You can, ethnography means you are living with that population. So suppose you are studying the tribes, you may act as a tribe and you go to a village, a tribal village, and live along with the tribes. It's called ethnography. So ethnography and case study is a part of qualitative research. But quantitative is different. Just questionnaire, schedules. We are using questionnaires and schedules for quantitative research. And sometimes the time series data. This is when you collect stock market data. It's a quantitative research. So data set you have learned that many different types of data sets. It's cross-sectional, time series, and panel. Right? Understand?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what about the next question? Qualitative and quantitative. Then two questions were asked.
Sir, I asked about the methodology of qualitative research.
The methodology, totally the methodology is different. Qualitative research methodology is different. So I said ethnography. Ethnography is a methodology for qualitative research. So some noise is coming. It's my problem or your problem? It's okay? Now it's okay, right?
Yes.
Okay. So ethnography is a part of qualitative research. Suppose you are studying a tribal village and you are checking whether the lives of people. So you go to that tribal village and live with the people in months, for 2 months or 3 months, you should stay with them. And you find that after their lifestyle, etc., you can understand. So that is a methodology for qualitative research. But quantitative research is different. The methodology means there are many different types of sampling method, and there are theoretical models. So you can find, you can, in quantitative research, there are theories. For example, you are proving the efficient market hypothesis. So efficient market hypothesis means market is efficient, nobody can make profit from the market. That is a theory given by the efficient market hypothesis by the pharma. But there are people who prove that this theory is foolish. So if theory is true, nobody can make profit from the market. So the person who found this theory got Nobel Prize. Pharma got Nobel Prize. And the person who proved that the theory was wrong, who got Nobel Prize. So there are people who strengthen the theory. There are people who violate, disproves the theory. So that's a methodology of quantitative research. Okay, Asha?
Yes, sir.
Any more doubts? Still you are confused? Methodology?
No, sir, it's just first part I'm clear. I just asked because I like to do a case study research in future, so that's why I asked.
So case study is a part of qualitative.
Qualitative.
So you recently, I think 2 months before, one open defense, and the topic was like something the candidate have written, like the title, and after that a case study. Okay, the title ended with a case study, a case study approach, but we haven't find any case study in that thesis, so we criticize, and I have asked questions. So your title saying that you are approaching, or you are doing a case study, but none of the case studies were presented in the topic. So that is again a dilemma in research. When you state your objective a case study, definitely a case study should be included in that topic, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Theory is very important in research. Theory means what? So every topic which is been connected with the theories. Some people, sir, I don't have theories. So how can I do research? So there are topics which is not supported by theories. We can also explore. We do that with the help of exploratory research. If your topic is really connected with the theories, you can find the theories related with your topic and models. You can strengthen the theory with your data. You can either you can strengthen the theory or you can disprove the theory. This theory is wrong. My data says that this theory was wrong. So theory is very important. So there are different theories, micro, meso and macro level theories. So theories, HCAPM, MM approach, efficient market hypothesis. These are theories. So you can connect your topic with the recent theories. So this is a methodology for theories. Like theoretical framework is very important. Then research subject selection. So you can develop your topic from the theories. Method of selection, evidence collection, data collection instruments. One of my scholar, she is doing research, and she motivated from the theory of nudges, nudging. Have you heard of nudging?
No, sir.
Anybody?
No.
No.
No, sir.
Okay. I'm surprisingly, you are not experienced the nudges before. So nudging is a theory which was developed by Richard Thaler, and he got Nobel Prize in the year of 2017 for developing nudge theory. So you might experience the nudges in every sector. I would like to say one example, which is LPG give up, subsidy give up. Are you experienced LPG subsidy give up? Huh?
Yes.
What is that?
To give up the subsidy provided.
So that's a plan introduced by the government. So what is the purpose
Yes.
of the plan? What is the purpose of the plan?
Availing LPG to the persons who are not able to purchase LPG.
So government can save a lot of money by giving subsidy to richer class people. So after that, many richer class people, they have taken these nudges and they said that they don't want subsidy. So a lot of money the government was saved due to the nudges. The nudges, this is called nudge, and which was introduced by the government purposefully. Okay. So you might have experience. I will show you some example. So this is a nudge. Are you able to see that nudge? So in Stockholm city, nudging its citizens used stairs by turning them into keys of piano. So 70% of the citizens preferring stairs over the escalator. So there was escalator and the stair, and the stairs by turning them into keys of piano. Then after that, people preferring stairs over the escalator. So what is that? Corona hats to nudge people to stay indoor. So this is another nudge. What is that? Who is the best player in the world? This is a waste bin. Ronaldo and Messi. So you can put waste in this basket. Who is the best player in the world? So we can fill it very fast. So again, that when you search in website, there suddenly some cookies or pop-ups comes in, and you can enter it and directly go to their website. So it's purposively given by the website. This is another nudge. A house fly painted onto the ceramic of urinal in a men's public toilet in Amsterdam airport. A house fly is painted onto the ceramic urinal. Then spillage of men's room floor fell by 80%. The target, the men evidently like to aim the target. So it was introduced by this is Tyler's example, the real contributor's example. So this is Tyler and Carson's team. They are the founders of nudge theory. It has been widely used in many areas, finance, HR, or marketing. So there are researchers which have started by taking nudge theory. So now we understand what is theory. So there is a theory, and you can take the research subject from the theory, and you can collect the method, and you can collect the data, instruments, and interviews, and after that the data will be analyzed, and you can prepare the thesis or paper, whatever it is. Okay, so the base one is theory. So nowadays the real lacking of things in our scholars is theory lacking. They don't know the theories of research. They when they submit the thesis, they don't have theories. So they are not interested to find theories connected with the topic that is fully against the ethics of research. So nowadays there are evaluators, they strictly ask, what is your theoretical model? That is the main question asked by the evaluators nowadays. So I can skip all these things. So there are theories, a lot of theories you can take and you can prove. Okay. So importance of theoretical framework. Theoretical framework is one of the main parts of research manuscript. So I would like to say again and again, theory is very important. I don't want to explain this slide. So you should find the theories connected with your topic. So can you find a research which don't have a theoretical framework? So recently one examiner asked, where is your theoretical framework? So theory is very important. Next is concept. So you know, some people are not able to demarcate what is a research topic, research area, and research title. If we ask what is your research area, they will say the title of the work. If we ask what is your research topic, they will say the title of work. So title is different from the topic, and the topic is different from the area. These three are different one. So suppose finance is a research area, and under finance you are dealing with mergers and acquisitions. That is a research topic. Your topic comes under mergers and acquisitions. Then you are studying the effectiveness. That is a title. So title is different from the topic. The topic is different from the research area. So first of all, you should consider what will be my research area. That the thing you need to consider the very beginning. Research area, research topic, and the last stage is to evolve a title. Okay, so title is very important. Once you set the title, it depends on the university. Our university style, when you set the title, it is final. And the same title you have to submit the thesis. You have to post when you submit the thesis. But in IIMs, IITs, and central universities, you can change the title before the 6 months of submission of the thesis. So that is a correct approach. When it is not right approach in which when we set the title before registration of PhD. That's a beginning time. We are not able to set the title at that time. So it is best to set the title before the submission of the thesis. That time we are able to finalize the title. But in our system is different one. The title is registered. The title is been typed in your registration letter. That title is fixed and you are not able to change the title. So you can change the title after getting the syndicate permission, and again the doctoral committee will be conducted. So you should be careful while setting the title in Kerala University. So Kerala University rule follows that way. Then variables. So variables, you might experience. Variable refers to properties or attributes of a concept that can be measured in some way. In short, a variable is measurable version of a concept. So when a concept is set, the variable is a measurable version of a concept. The process to transform a concept into variable is called operationalization. The process to transform a concept into variable is called operationalization. And to take an example, age is a variable, but the answer to the question "How old are you?" is a variable. Okay. Another example: women's representation in parliament can be easily measured by the percentage of seats in the elected assembly, which are occupied by women. So types of variable: dependent variable. So the variable is the variable researcher is trying to explain. Suppose you are trying to explain job satisfaction. Job satisfaction is a dependent variable. Suppose you are trying to explain the organizational commitment. The commitment is a dependent variable. So organization commitment sometimes depends on the job satisfaction. So job satisfaction is an independent variable. Organizational commitment is a dependent variable. So in quantitative studies, the dependent variable has the notation OI. Then independent variable is hypothesized to explain variation in the dependent variable. Independent variable are sometimes also called explanatory variables. So in quantitative studies, independent variable has a notation of x. You might have experienced the formula y is equal to alpha plus beta x1 plus beta x2 plus beta x3 plus beta x4 beta xn. So alpha is constant, beta is varied according to the variables. So there are some spurious relationship in the variable. Spurious means it's the way the relationship is not correct one. Example, the number of astronauts dying in the spacecraft is directly correlated to seat belts used in car. So, so if you conduct the research, there is a relationship and the score, the R square value will be high, but that relationship is spurious one. So it's not the correct relationship. So that relationship is called spurious form. So after the research, some findings may be evolved after the spurious findings. It's called as use your seatbelt and save an astronaut life. So that's again problem. We can find many spurious correlations and spurious regressions in our researches. So that is not the real research. So do not choose a useless title for your research work. So title is very important. I already explained this slide, research area, research topic and research title is different. So research title should have the following characteristics, short, descriptive, to the point, contain key variables, relate to the topic, attract attention. If you read some of the title in the research, you may laugh. Okay, there are some foolish site titles in researchers. The selection of research title is a task to the researcher. Once a title is set, it is fixed. So, one second, I will. Hello, madam. Ah, oh, pare, pare. And there. അല്ല ആദ്യം തന്നെ ടെൻഡ് അതിനകത്ത് ഹോളിഡേയ്സും കൂടി ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു ഇപ്പൊ അതിനകത്ത് കണ്ടിന്യൂസ് ആയിട്ടാ വരണം ഓക്കെ അപ്പൊ അപ്പൊ ഒന്നും കൂടി തരണോ ഒന്നും കൂടി തരണോ ആ ആ ഓക്കെ ഇറ്റ്സ് ഫൈൻ യു കൻ ചേഞ്ച് ടു 10 ഡേയ്സ് ദാറ്റ്സ് ഓക്കെ മാർച്ച് ആ ഒരു അത് കുഴപ്പമൊന്നുമില്ല അങ്ങനെ മാറ്റി നമുക്ക് പ്രശ്നമില്ല വി ആർ റെഡി ടു ഡു ദാറ്റ് നയൻ ആയിട്ടേക്കുന്നു സൺഡേ ഉൾപ്പെടെ ആയിട്ടേക്കുന്നു മറ്റേത് ഇടയ്ക്ക് അതെ അതെ സൺഡേ ആണ് വരുന്നത് കോൺഫറൻസ് ലാസ്റ്റ് ആ ആ ഓക്കെ So next, selection of research title is a task to the researcher. Once the title is set, it is fixed. So this slide already explained. So how can, what are things when you consider while fixing title, things to be considered? Title play a key role in helping people. So there is some notes. Okay, so what happened is my problem. So how can I set the title or your title is You feeling some disturbances?
Krishna Priya, your audio is unmuted. Please mute.
So, title of research, the first step is to look seriously, critically, and comparatively at a range of possible alternatives. So there are many alternatives. At least you have set 10 or 15 titles. Then you select the best one. So that is a one way of selection of title. Try and think things through from the reader's point of view. So you can type your title in Google and what many papers will pop up after that. You can check that. So how will this wording be interpreted by someone scanning on Google Scholar? So the title is very important. It's very important nowadays. So your title is very. If your title is a catchy one, you will get more citations. So that you can type the title in the Google Scholar, and what many papers will come up, and the papers are more, and you will get more citations. So what will attract them to click through the research? Recommend generating a minimum 10 possible titles and consider them carefully. Compare these alternatives with each other and see if recombining words from different titles might work better. So type your possible titles as research search terms into Google Scholar or Scopus, a web of science subject to specific databases, and see what existing work comes up. So you can search your title in Google Scholar or Scopus or Web of Science and find that what are the related papers comes up. Related papers comes up after typing your keywords. So finally, you are able to select the best title. So this is very important for the selection of title. You can search your title in Google Scholar, Scopus, or Web of Science. Okay. So, any doubts so far? So, this is a new ways of. There are researches, in social science research. Every day, new phenomenon, new technology, new analyzing softwares. Okay. So now there are many softwares for data analytics, R, MATLAB. Stata, EVUs, and the SPSS is all over a period of time we have been using SPSS also. So similarly, there are softwares for visualization. Tableau is a new software which is been used for data visualization. Okay, so there are quantitative tools are every day there are new tools coming up. If we are not concentrating or if we are not looking on this area, we may be outdated. So some of the publications, they will take only from the result which comes up from the original softwares. If you use the pirated SPSS version and if you do an analytics, they won't take the paper which comes from the analytics which has been done using a pirated software. So you should be careful while doing a data analytics in open source software. That will be very well approached to publish, to get published. Okay, so any more doubts? So you can ask doubts. It's already 11:17. I will wind up 11:30. Okay, so see, the my contents are very vast. So what I'm focusing is like research is not shortcut, and you should deeply involve in research. Every day you can find new models, new theories. And you can include or you can connect your research topic with theories, and based on that you can collect the model and you can strengthen the theory. So there are some myths, like superstition about the researchers, but you can remove myth. Like the thing is, you can start publish papers in journals. In journal means SFIR or Scopus, Web of Science, ABDC list journals. If you publish in this type of good journal, you'll be rewarded. Suddenly, if you'll be placed in better institutes. So even I am willing to collaborate with you. If you have good teams, we can collaborate and we can prepare papers and publish it. Okay, so select best area and try to start publications. So that's one way to learn more about research. Okay, then you are in a stepping stone of registration of PhD. So you started MPhil. You can find an area now, right now, within a month, and you can develop it, and you can publish papers in that area. Okay, that's all my presentation. You can ask doubts. 10 minutes, we can discuss it. I hope everybody asked some questions.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
So this is Anne Susan. Sir, yes. So I had a doubt regarding the publications and publications in books. Like when we have calls for papers for ISBN edited books, but with no ISBN numbers being specified in those